As Democrats gather in this southern city on the eve of the convention, we look at the changing political landscape of the South with Democratic Senator Kay Hagan of North Carolina and Kareem Crayton. He is a professor at the University of North Carolina School of Law, and he studies race and politics. And we thank you both for being with us.
Thank you, Judy.
Thank you.
So, Senator Hagan, we just heard that report from Andy Cohut about sliding support for the president among much of the electorate, especially among white voters. Here in the South, it seems Democrats are particularly having a tough time. Why is that?
Well, I think there's several things. You go back to 2008, and in North Carolina, we had close to 4.5 million people vote. And then in 2010, we only had a little over 3 million votes. So 1.5 million people stayed home. And I think the landscape changed in North Carolina during that period of time. And I think a lot of people are wondering, well, what's happened? But when I look at what's happened in Congress with the frustration, with the inability to get things done, I think the public has forgotten that when Mitch McConnell stands up on the Senate floor and says, you know, I don't want to move legislation forward, I want this president to be a one-term president, it's hard for President Obama to get his policies put forward. I mean, the last week we were in session, we couldn't even get on a motion to proceed to a cybersecurity bill because of the obstruction going on. And I think that message hasn't resonated with the public.
Professor Crayton, if what the senator says is correct and people are just so disheartened about Washington, what about the South in particular is affected by this? Is the South out of reach for a Democrat like Barack Obama this time around?
It's not out of reach, but he's definitely sailing into headwinds. In addition to what Senator Hagan said, there are, of course, these long-term trends that certainly make it more difficult for Democrats to compete, having to do in part with the enfranchisement of African Americans since 1965. Once you get a large number of African Americans voting, supporting the Democratic Party, you get a distancing among some white voters in the South from the Democratic platform. In part, some would say because the Democratic platform went farther away from where they were, but sometimes also because they weren't all that comfortable voting for issues having to do with African-American favored interests. And so those are things that I think Democrats in the South running have to work against, putting coalitions together. North Carolina has been a place where that's happened, but it is a hard sell, particularly in an economic climate where independent voters, many of them white, are in some ways dispirited and wondering what federal government is going to do to deal with jobs.
Can I ask Senator Hagan, a colleague of yours, Senator Jim Webb of Virginia, another big battleground state, was quoted as saying, how can it be that in the party of Andrew Jackson, only 28% of white working males support the Democratic Party? Is that a long-term problem for the Democratic Party, not only in North Carolina, but throughout the South?
I think we've seen that historically over probably the last 40 years. But I do think that we have, with the convention in Charlotte, with the convention in North Carolina this week, that people across North Carolina are proud of the fact that the Democratic Party chose to have a convention here in North Carolina. We are the New South. We are a party with a huge tent, and we welcome everybody that you will see on the floor beginning tomorrow. And if you walk the streets in Charlotte today for the Carolina Fest, you've seen that over and over again with people of all races, all nationalities coming here to celebrate the feeling and the Southern hospitality that's been extended to them.
Kareem Crayton, as we said, one of the things you specialize in is looking at voting rights. We know from what's been happening in the last several months of this year, Republicans across the country in particular moving move on voter, restricting voter access. They talk about trying to limit fraud and eliminate fraud. The view from the Democratic Party is different. But my question is, if you take all that together, how much does that affect the Democratic Party's ability to do what it needs to do in the South?
It is a serious assault on the work that Democrats do to win. Democrats, in order to be successful, and in many places like North Carolina, they have been successful, have matched significant turnout among African Americans and great turnout among independent to moderate white voters. And it's been done on a number of issues having to do with jobs, et cetera. How do the voting rules affect it? Limited voting limits the ability of African Americans to utilize Sunday voting, voter ID rules in a lot of states have been adopted that limits access to those who have driver's licenses. Many poor, many older, many African-American voters don't have it. These are going to be things that drive down the ability of African-Americans to turn out. And in a tight race, those small numbers matter.
Senator Hagan, I want to follow up on that because it seems to me that if you raise the question of voter suppression, as Democrats have, if you raise the question about redistricting, which is also carved out districts which make it very difficult for any kind of racial mix to happen, I wonder how you see a path toward future Democratic growth, especially in a state that the president won by, half a percentage point last
14,000
time?
14,000 votes.
Yeah.
Well, I think two things. I do think that what you're seeing right now in North Carolina with the Republican-controlled Senate and House, and in 2010, the House and the Senate went Republican for the first time since about 1880. Yeah. So all of a sudden, you're getting these suppression of the voting rolls. And there's no reason for it other than to suppress the Democratic vote. And I think that that's a huge problem. As far as redistricting, you know, you can look at current sitting senators and the redistricting map picked two houses from one county and put one woman in a one strong Democratic woman in a strong Republican
state. What do you do about
district? Well, I think the courts are going to have to be able to solve that issue and look at to see if this is abiding under the Voting Rights Act. And if not, then certainly we can change that. And I think that it's in the court system right now.
Given the picture that the two of you have painted throughout this conversation, Kareem Crayton, what does this president need to do if he's going to have a serious chance of winning in November across the South, not just in North Carolina?
Well, I think two things, and they probably are things that you've heard, Ms. Cutter say in her interview. One is obviously he's got to articulate a message that it reignites people who were excited about him in 2008, that this isn't a red or a blue America. This isn't also a black or white America, but there are issues that we all are concerned about that we need to work together to build. Second, I think, and this is the, you know, door-to-door talking to people idea that a lot of folks earlier in the panel were talking about, getting people mobilized, showing up and getting every potential vote out there. So utilizing what's left of early voting to get people mobilized and making sure that on Election Day, as few obstacles are in place as possible so that people can get ballots cast.
All right. Kareem Crayton and Senator Kay Hagan, we thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you both very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.